everyone, and welcome back to my channel. The job of being an environmental scientist isn't easy. You must master the concepts of science, communication, policy, critical thinking, building your network, all while being challenged by a group of people. But it is well worth it, and no job can match the satisfaction that you can get out of this field if you truly have the passion. With this video, I want to give you a step-by-step plan to becoming an environmental scientist. Use it as an inspiration to develop your own career plan and personalize it to you. So let's get into it. If you're new here, my name is Maddie and I'm a work from home energy consultant. In 2022, I graduated from the University of Maryland with a bachelor's degree in environmental science and policy. So I know firsthand what it takes to get into the field of environmental science, the ups and the downs, the pros and the cons, and I want to share that with you. And I also want to share some tips and tricks to actually pursuing a career in environmental science. So in this video, first we'll look at what an environmental scientist actually does, what different forms their jobs can take, and then we'll look at what the industry is looking like in 2024. Then we'll go step by step through this roadmap that I've laid out, starting with choosing what your specialization is going to be. Now, this roadmap can be helpful at any point in your career, whether you're just starting out or whether you're 10 years in. But I will just say a quick disclaimer, I'm about 2 years into my career as an energy consultant and graduated from UMD in 2022. So this really is geared towards those who are in college and might be looking to further their career in environmental sciences once they graduate. So if that sounds like you, let's get into it. So first, what does an environmental science actually do? Well, environmental scientists analyze field samples and survey results to learn about environmental conditions and trends. They will often travel to outdoor sites to do their observations and take notes. In the field, they'll take samples of things like plant matter, soil, and water, and then they'll take it back to the laboratory to analyze it with other scientists under a microscope. Now, environmental scientists are everywhere, but you will need them most where the built environment meets the natural environment. And I've referred to these two terms before in my videos, but essentially the built environment refers to urban areas like cities where you have a lot of structures, and even suburban areas where you have a lot of housing developments. And the natural environment refers to wilder areas such as natural parks, national forests, conservation areas, and things like that. So the jobs for environmental scientists are concentrated in places like natural parks, coastal areas, and areas like Superfund sites. Now, when you're applying to these jobs, you'll want to look into places that have a lot of funding and projects in this area. Some common states where they do put a lot of funding towards environmental projects are states like Colorado, California, Alaska, Maine, Vermont, and New Mexico. But you'll also want to consider that the job outlook is pretty great for environmental scientists over the next 10 years. The Bureau of Labor Statistics predicts a 6% growth in environmental scientists specifically from 2022 to 2032. And this is higher than average across all other occupations. Now, a big question when looking into statistics on environmental scientists is the salary. Now, the Bureau of Labor Statistics also says that the median annual salary in May of 2022 for environmental scientists was around $76,000, with the highest percent earning more than $130,000. Now, I will say with a caveat here, this pay depends on both where you're living and what industry you're in, along with a number of other factors that we won't get into today, but they found that the highest paying industries were in government, consulting, and engineering services. So that is something to keep in mind as you're choosing your major and going throughout college and choosing your internships, and then finally applying to jobs. So with that background in mind of what goes into being an environmental scientist, let's get into the step-by-step roadmap to becoming one. All right, so the first step is to choose your specialization. Now, environmental science tends to be a very broad umbrella, so one of the first things you do want to do is pick what specific niche you're going to want to tune into within the umbrella of environmental science. Now, it is a good idea to choose early because then that can help inform your internships, your jobs that you choose, the classes that you take in college. But if you decide to switch specializations or completely switch into the environmental science field well into your career, that's also totally fine. This is just what I've found based on my experience. And for some, it might be really really easy to choose your specialization. You might have been really interested in wildlife biology from a very young age, and you know that you're going to be going into that throughout the rest of your career. But for others, it might take a little bit of experimentation during college or even in high school to figure out what your niche is and where your passion really lies. Another thing to consider if you are just starting out in college or maybe you're a senior in high school is that as you learn more about the field, other specializations will make themselves apparent to you, so you might not have even heard about what your future niche is going to be because you're going to learn about it your first year or two of college. Now, as you do make your decision about what you're going to specialize in, you'll want to make sure to get an external opinions and do a lot of research on what goes into each specialization. That way you can come in informed and know what kind of internships and what kind of jobs you're going to get once you're actually in the field. Now you may be asking, well, Maddie, what are these specializations that you keep talking about? Well, a few examples would be wildlife biology, conservation biology, and biodiversity, which are pretty similar, evolutionary biology, environmental chemistry, hydrology, which is the study of water, geology, geography, and GIS work, and marine science, which is a very popular one these days. And that leads us to the next step in the roadmap, which is earning a bachelor's degree. A lot of the specializations we just talked about, if you want to get a decent job in that field, they usually require a bachelor's degree, if not more, like a master's or PhD. So I did want to mention earning your bachelor's degree in this roadmap. Now, in this step, you have, to begin with, two primary decisions to make. You have what college to attend, and you want to choose what your major is. Now, the college you end up going to does depend on a few factors like location, your grades, your extracurriculars in high school, but you do generally want to try to go to a school that has a very robust environmental program if you're interested in going in the environmental sciences. Obviously. Usually these schools have a specific environmental science program, and you'll want to do research on the research going on at the school and what the faculty is up to. If the faculty is really involved and publishing a ton of research papers, that's great, and you might want to reach out to some of those faculty. Now, ideally, the school has an actual environmental sciences program with faculty specifically dedicated towards that program so that future you can have a number of resources and opportunities at your disposal once you get there. But if the school that you end up going to doesn't have a specific program in environmental science, other things you can do is look out for the sustainability initiatives that they're doing. A lot of schools now have an actual office of sustainability, and they run campaigns like recycling campaigns, composting campaigns, stream cleanups, or just general trash cleanups. So you'll want to check out those and try to get involved in that kind of community as well, as it will help grow your network, and they're just fun. So check those out before you make your decision on where to go to college. Now, in terms of what major to choose, that will be informed by the specialty or the niche that you're choosing, but I am going to make a video on what major you should choose depending on what your specialization is, so I'll link that in the cards once it's available. You're not always going to want to be choosing environmental science as your major, for example. So just as a quick example, if you decided that you wanted to go into marine sciences or marine biology, your major could be marine biology if the school has that major. It could be biology, it could be chemistry, it could be environmental sciences, it could be biodiversity. It really depends on what the college has to offer and what your skill set is as well. Now, if at this point you haven't yet landed on a specialization, a great way to come to that decision is in step 3 of our roadmap, which is gaining some hands-on experience. And even if you have decided what specialization to take on, getting some hands-on experience during college will really set you apart from other job applicants going forward. It will elevate your career. And after all, being an environmental scientist does involve getting your hands dirty, so might as well start that experience early. A lot of times that experience is already incorporated into your major in college in the form of a research assistantship or an experiential learning process. But a few things that you'll want to look into when you're deciding on what internship to do is a great mentor who evidently cares about the successes of their students, opportunities to learn more hard skills so that you can add those to your resume, skills like coding, data analysis, lab work, field work, stuff like that. If you're doing a summer internship, it might be really cool to go to a different biome or environment than you're used to get a feel for what different biomes kind of have to offer. I would also recommend looking for an internship that already has an established network of other college interns. That way you can establish a sense of community with your peers And you know that the internship itself has already established a process for mentoring their students. And then this last tip that I think might be a little bit controversial, but I do think that all of your college internships should have a paycheck associated with them. After all, you do have a high school diploma and some college experience already, so you should be getting paid for the work that you're doing, especially if you're putting in 30, 40 hours a week over the summer. I truly think that the work you're doing does deserve some form of monetary compensation. So that's obviously your decision, but coming from someone who had both unpaid and paid internships during college, you really want to go for those paid ones. Now, at this point, you have your degree in hand, you have a resume full of skills, experiences, and research, you have a network of peers and mentors, so now it's time to get to step four, which is actually applying for jobs. So for many, this is often the most stressful part of becoming an environmental scientist, but also for many, it's usually the most necessary or the most crucial. After all, after spending 4 years paying for an undergraduate degree without a regular paycheck, you might be feeling the need for one, or your bank account might be feeling the need for one. So when you apply, the first thing that I always recommend folks to do is to start by reaching out to your mentors and to your network to see if they know of any jobs available. And I want to emphasize that this should really be the starting point. I see so many new grads applying to hundreds of random jobs through LinkedIn or Indeed and getting nowhere. But the network that you built throughout your undergraduate degree is an asset that you can leverage to make your job application process just that much easier. The people in your network know where you want to work, what you want to do, how you work, and what your passions are. So you might as well start with them because they can be a voice of reason and they can be on your side when you're actually applying to those jobs that they recommend. Of course, your resume, cover letter, and writing samples and other work samples do matter as well, but nothing beats knowing someone that's close to the job that you really want. Now, if you are currently a senior in college and you're wondering when you should start applying to jobs and what the timing of all of that is, it really does depend on your specialization. I found that most companies that are hiring environmental scientists tend to put out job postings in February to April timeframe, and they'll send out offers in May. So if you are a senior and you haven't yet secured a job, that's totally okay. You still have plenty of time. That brings us to step five of the roadmap, which is to consider pursuing a master's degree. Now, this might actually be step four for you with a job coming after that, and it really also depends on your specialization. For those who are going into consulting, usually you'll want to get into the workforce first and establish a few connections there and then go for your master's. But for more research-focused roles, you will want to get that further master's degree so that you can expand on your research skills, build your own thesis, and then go for a position. In general, master's degrees are really strong in the environmental science field. It can help you build your network. Again, it can enhance your skills in research and your hard skills and writing and data analysis and those essential skills that are really the core of environmental science. It can also give you the opportunity to niche down even further and become a true expert in something very specific, and that helps secure your jobs in the future. Generally, this step just does help build your career in very similar ways to earning a bachelor's degree, just at a more advanced level. And that's the roadmap. Hopefully at this point you kind of have a general idea of what it takes to become a successful environmental scientist and what steps you can take on your own path with your own specialization to get there. Before we end today's video, I do just want to give one more piece of advice to those who are wanting to pursue a career in environmental science, and that is to keep remembering your why each and every day. Remembering why you are spending all of these hours working towards your degree or working your job is so crucial to avoiding burnout, doing good work in your career, and truly living in your passion. For some, remembering your why could be going to stream and beach cleanups with your local community, it could be going on a walk every day, or it could be volunteering at your local animal shelter. Whatever it is for you, find it out early and do it often, and remember that nature can be your best teacher in all of this. So there you have it, your career roadmap to becoming an environmental scientist. If you enjoyed this video and found it helpful, give it some love by giving it a thumbs up and subscribing to the channel, and comment what your specialization within the environmental science umbrella is. I'll see you in the next video. Bye!